Welcome to Business Meets Spirituality, where we believe in personal growth through business success. I'm joined by Hallie Warner, and both of our voices today are going to be a little down. And Hallie actually just told me that I am going to win every argument that she throws today because we just came off a four-day bender of speaking nonstop at events throughout the great state of Texas in Dallas. Yes, it's a struggle for everybody here today. So we're super excited to be here because we also, though, by doing that, you get a lot of clarity and you get a lot of questions from people who are listening to this podcast. And one question really resonated a lot, right, Hallie?
Yeah, well, it's a question that we got both at the event from all our various speaking engagements while we were there and panels and networking. But it's a question that we get a lot from our book and people who read our blog and who are messaging us and emailing us. And the question is...
What is the question?
You can say it.
I could say it? Yeah. Well, I mean, so Hallie doesn't want to talk about it. But so people ask a lot and they say, well, hey, how do I go hire a Hallie? Right? We hear that like, hey, where do I go find my Hallie? Hallie's not like hiding underneath a Christmas tree somewhere, right? Like people think like it's just going to be like, you're going to go to like Walmart and it's going to be on an aisle and you pick the person up. And I'm just having fun with the conversation. But then Hallie always turns around and asks the different question. If a CEO, an entrepreneur, an executive asks me and says, how do I go find a Hallie? Hallie turns around and says...
And I always ask them back, well, are you an Adam?
And I think that is the key point, not that are you Adam. It's anybody that you're looking up to that has achieved some level of success, at least in the material world. And really what that matters is business equals people, right? There's no question about that. If you're running a business, there's people involved. A sole entrepreneur or sole proprietorship can run a business by themselves through themselves. That's different. Nothing wrong with that. But when you're talking about building a business, whether you're building somebody else's business, you're building a division of a business, you have a part in building a business, but when you're building that, you then start leading with people. And business equals people because the people that you hire, attract, and keep will grow your business to the level that people that you have. However, the problem with business is people.
Yes.
Because you can, it's for all the different reasons, from people leaving, to people stealing, to people not showing up, to people not being held accountable, all of these things that show up. You know, it's actually funny. We were sitting down and we were in a talent meeting over the weekend with an individual, and this guy was with me also interviewing her as well too, and said, hey, you know, this job isn't for everybody. And I sat there for a second and I just had to share this after they got done their rant. I said, well, of course it's not for everybody. Like, right? Like, think about just that context. Like, oh, this job isn't for everybody. Just think, like, is football, like professional sports teams for everybody? No. Like, if you're running at the level that we're talking about, how do I hire a Hallie, or how do you be an Adam, or how to be fill in the blank for whoever you're trying to be, yes, of course not. I mean, very few people. I actually responded and said, I wouldn't want less than, there's probably 1% of people that are out there that you would actually hire. Mm-hmm. And so, of course, it's not for everybody. And so then the question becomes, how do you go after and how do you attract that 1%?
Yeah, because when people ask us that question, what they're really asking is, I'm looking for a talented high achiever who's going to help my business grow. And with our responses, well, then you need to be a talented high achiever.
Yes.
In an amazing leader as well.
Yes.
So then how do we help somebody become that talented leader in order to attract the right people?
Yeah, and I think the key concept to this is that there's not one thing that you can do. We could put a blanket statement that says self-leadership precedes leadership, meaning that you become the leader, but that's still philosophical, right? It's still like people hear that, oh, be the leader, and say like, well, I'm a leader, but how come I don't have, you know, my, you know, Gary Keller or Tony Robbins next to me, right? How come I don't have that person? Well, it's because then you got to break it down even way beyond what leadership, the definition of leadership means, and really making sure that you're focused. You're doing really tough things every single day that are growing yourself. I literally wake up every single day with the intention behind myself to make sure that I'm a better leader, human being, father, you know, business owner than I was the day before. That's and Michael Jordan said that, right? He said in the very beginning, he said, I don't compete with anybody else. I'm only competing with who I am and how I get better. And so the question becomes, wherever you're starting out, and I think we talked about this before we jumped in the podcast, one thing I want people to take away from this is that wherever you are, you can always be the shiner of what group you're in, meaning you can always shine whatever level you're playing at currently in order to get to the next level. Because we know that when you're building a business or you're an executive building a business, whatever that concept is that you're moving through, you always move through levels. Now, the faster you work on yourself, the more faster you work through these levels. But just like when you're in peewee baseball, right? And you're, before you get to the major leagues, you've played in peewee baseball, right? And how do you be the star in the peewee baseball? You show up earlier, you work harder, you listen to the coaches, you follow the wisdom that people are doing there, you hold yourself accountable to the results, right? You just, and it comes, you work tirelessly.
It's a difference between being a professional and amateur in whatever you do.
Yes, exactly. And then like right from peewee, you then move to call it middle school. Then middle school, how do you be the one that's showing up more, right? And then
do you lead the group? How are you showing up? Are you the captain? Are you, even if you're not the captain, are you leading through influence by planning other events or, you know, helping the team engage?
That's exactly right. I mean, and so when a coach is coaching an eighth grade baseball team, they can clearly see who the captains are. They can clearly see the people who are shining. In fact, you in the group can clearly see the people who are shining.
And it doesn't always mean they're the best at the actual sport, though. They could just be the best at leading others.
Well, that's the question. Then you're driving into like job versus leadership, right? Like you brought me down that path. Yeah. Yes, you can be that. But you're right though. It doesn't matter. So if you're really good at your job, then you perform really well as your job or an individual athlete. If you're shining as a leader, then your path will then ultimately lead to being the best in leadership that you can be, right? And so that's just in sports is easy to see that, right? So you can do that. And then when you get in high school, how do you be the shining star of the high school? You just keep applying that same format to everything that you do. It's also a level of confidence, not hubris. Hubris means that I know everything and I'm the best. Confidence just means I actually don't know anything. In fact, the more I learn, I actually know nothing, but I'm willing to put in the time and energy and effort to make sure that I learn it because I know that I can, right? And then I can apply it to my life no matter what that I do, right? So if you want to attract these type of people that are in your life so you can build the business that you want so that you can exceed and achieve the freedom and the financial measurements that you want, you have to start no matter where you are shining and being the individual that shows up differently than everybody else. I guess that's where I was going with that question. When they said, hey, we know this job isn't for everybody. Yeah, how do you show up differently so that the people that are actually going to make that next hire in you or invest into you look at you and say, yeah, they're different. They're different. Which when you're different, if 99% of people are going left, you go right. And by the way, when you go right, it's going to feel like you're out in the middle of the forest. But the one person that's sitting back there watching the entire group that's just achieved the level above you is watching the one or two people that go right. A great example of this, and I've shared this in limitless courses and stuff that we have, and it's just it was really fascinating. I had a professor in college. His name was Jim Gatti, Professor Gatti. Him and I became pretty good friends afterwards. And he was notorious in college for having the toughest exams. And it was University of Vermont in finance. And finance was the toughest course you could take in the business school. And a lot of it had to do with him because everyone had this one class called 181. It was Biz Ad 181. And it was so hard, right? And he made his exam so hard. Now, what he did do, he's always curved them. But every exam that you would take, the median in the class would be like a 30. And he'd end up scaling it like 50 points or whatever it is. So you just knew you'd scale it. And so everyone would end up getting their grades up, right? He was also, by the way, he was the one professor who taught this course called Advanced Honors Wall Street Seminar, which it's funny let me just finish the story and I'll loop back into that story. So anyways, he always curved the exam. So anyway, when we got done school, about a couple of years afterwards, I started achieving a little level of success. I asked him to go play golf. And I think it's important to stay connected to those people. So I ended up playing golf with him. We were having a couple rounds. And I sat there and we were like, I remember this. We were just about to tee off. And I said, hey, Jim, I got to ask you. It was so funny at calling him Jim, by the way, because it was always professor. And I said, hey, Jim, right? And I said, he's so gruff and short. And it's just the way he responds. I said, why did you make your test so hard? Like, why you ended up scaling him? He goes, well, Adam, you're missing the whole point. He said, it was very easy. He said, if I made my exam so that everyone could get an 85 on them, how would I know the people that shined? How would I know the people that actually stood out? Because every time I had an exam, one or two people got a 75 or an 80 before the scale, and everyone else was a 30. So I made my tests, I made the environment so difficult that only a few people could actually achieve the level that I wanted to see people achieving at before I scaled. And so it was his way of identifying talent, right? Because now everyone's at a 30. The median's at a 30 and you've got two or three people getting a 70 or an 80 on the exam, how much do they show up differently? It's very clear, right? And so it was a really powerful thing. So I think it's the same way. How do, if everyone else is running at a 30, how do you show up as an 80? Right? How do you be the one that's showing up so somebody else can see you? So anyways, you know, and what's really fascinating is he was kind of closing the loop on this. He was, he also taught a course called Advanced Honors Wall Street Seminar, which in those exams, by the way, I probably got like a 50. I was like 20 points above. There was definitely clearly a couple people that were just intelligently smarter than I am for books and test taking. In fact, there was one individual there. He's a really good friend of mine. He's actually extremely, he's like one of the first 30 employees at Amazon, and he's just killing it over there right now. He would literally study for like an hour for like these exams. And I would study for like 100 and he would go in there and get like literally be the one guy that got like an 85, like unbelievable. The way he intellectually could understand things was really incredible. I think everyone knows those people. But anyway, so he was in charge of this course that was very lauded in the business school that everyone wanted to get into. And they allowed 6 people in the course out of the entire business school, which, you know, had 10,000 kids in it, right? It was called Advanced Honors Wall Street Seminar. And guess who taught that course? Jim Gotti, because he was the one that was best at what? Identifying talent throughout the entire business school. And so the reason why he taught it and what was funded was all of these investment firms down on Wall Street who had gone through Gotti and knew that who would know the most talented people would be Jim. Cool. So it all made a ton of sense after the fact, right? Of course, when you're in there taking the exam, you're like just frustrated, but this is so difficult and do this. But when you kind of look back on this and you run your own business, you're like, wow, that was an amazing job of setting up talent. So it was the day that he was selecting it. I remember just staying in my dorm room just by my email. This is before that we had even cell phones, right? A pager, but pager, you couldn't get like an email from it, right? But I remember sitting there like, do I get selected in this course? Do I get selected in this course? Because it wasn't just in his class, it was and on all classes. And I was the 6th person into that class. And what's funny is people got frustrated with me that I got in it because there was people that had higher grades and that were more on some boards and doing all these different things and all this stuff. I actually got put in the group. I had like a B in his group and everyone else like an A+, and was like chairman of this and this sorority and all these different things. And there's just me. Right. And later on I asked him, I said, why did I get chosen in that group? And I beat out other people. And he just said, clearly your work ethic was harder than anybody else I've ever seen. And I was like, when you're doing your work ethic, it wasn't like I was doing it, like thinking that I was working harder than everybody else. Like you just do it. You just show up. Right. And so I thought, that was kind of interesting that how clearly he could see that. And it wasn't all about the intellectual, right? So like he put that into that course. And by the way, that course getting in there was the one, it was like a 6-month semester and we were interning down on Wall Street, which allowed us to go present high yield bond recommendations to these massive boards on Wall Street, which, you know, then I, in that group, guess what? I tried to take the lead and actually present everything in there. And on a side note, this whole story, the first time we flew down there, like the school paid for us to fly down there. We got a hotel and we're all in there and we're all in all our suits and we're like in college. And I go in there and like, they're like, okay, Adam, you're going to start this presentation off. Cause of course I volunteered to like jump in there and I'll present this whole thing. I got these guys, right? Like this type of thing. I get in the board and I forget what the first, it was a junk bond recommendation. And there's this literally like this, an actual Wall Street, and it's called Julian Loki Howard Group. And it was one of the groups there. And they had a investment banking. There's like 13 investment bankers, senior investment bankers that are all in there. I'm walking in and I started sweating. I was like, these guys are extremely intimidating. First of all, you're just on Wall Street and like everything is just different than Vermont, right? And I'm in this board meeting and I start off in the first like 6 minutes, I'm stumbling over my words. I'm trying to make this recommendation. And one of the guys just stops me midway and he's like, none of what you're saying right now makes sense. And I was like, and I just looked at my professor like he was going to come up and save me. He just looked at me and like, dude, you're on your own right now. Like, this is exactly what you need to learn. I'm looking at everyone else to try to jump in. But after that guy just made that comment, nobody else is jumping in right now. And so I'm like, damn, like this is a stressful moment for me right now. But it was a really cool gift because I just got to work through it and we got to massage the whole thing. And anyways, it ended up working out. And I ended up, the story, you know, we kind of worked through those whole things. We worked with another firm and pretty much everybody in that group got a job offer down on Wall Street. If you wanted it, you can go down there because it was guaranteed if you got into that group that you would have some sort of job offer on Wall Street. And of course, majority of them, except for me, did. I stayed in Vermont for other reasons, but it was clear as day there. So it doesn't matter what level you're at. The thing is, wherever you're at, how do you stand out? How do you be the individual that's going to run faster, that run right when everyone runs left? How are you going to be the one that either outworks them, outthinks them, is a different thought leader? You bring a concept to the world, hence business meets spirituality, right? How do you bring something that somebody else isn't, or maybe it's just beginning? How do you bring that out? How do you do something in your current profession that everyone else is doing that you just decide to go a different direction on? Whether you succeed or not actually isn't the answer. I mean, success is great from that, but really talented leaders see when people are going against the grain to actually go, they might not have succeeded in that, but boy, that took a lot of risk and guts, right? That took a lot of drive and energy to do that. How do I get in relationship with them? So that's what you do, right? And so when you think about that, how I see you've been taking copious notes over here. I know they're questions.
A couple of points about what you just said that we can then take that and apply it to business. So one of the things I heard you say is that that your professor did is he was watching talent for a while before he placed them in that advanced honors Wall Street course. So when we're hiring talent, one of the best places to start is looking internally, because it gives you, it's almost like a training ground for your own talent for different positions. So I just wanted people to, hear that, great. That really watch. The best way is just to watch what they do, watch how they show up. And then you can tap them for different opportunities or for bigger opportunities along the way. And then the other thing I heard you say is that, really with the testing made me think of, one, looking for the track record of success, which you were just talking about. And then two, once you are about to hire somebody or getting close to hiring somebody, giving them some sort of test, giving them an assignment, having them shadow you for a day, or having them, in our case, we had some of our most recent hires do an assignment or write some sort of proposal for us to see how they would perform. And we ended up hiring them because they did a great job on those things. So those are just some different ways to really make sure you're hiring the right people.
Yeah, in fact, right now we're actually thinking about launching another company, and I actually had an individual we're taking along give me an entire presentation about what he would do if he got rewarded this leadership position, what would be the first 30 days that he did. And he typed out this entire, 20-page booklet about what he would do. And the answer, it doesn't matter what the answer is, right?
Right. I think two things. One, does somebody even do it?
Yes.
Which is the first piece. And then two, what does it look like? Does it look like something you could actually use in your business? Actually, now that I think about it, before I got hired here, this is almost 10 years ago, I applied for another job and they had me do that. They had me write this whole zoning proposal, and I had no idea. I knew nothing about development and zoning, and I had to write this entire proposal. I did a ton of research and I wrote it, and they had told me they hired me because they said they could have actually used that proposal in their business that day. And I had no idea what I was doing. So one reason why we do that for other people.
And I can see on the other side, I can think of an individual that you probably can too, that came in, interviewed very well, definitely showed a lot of talent, was kind of going a little up and down different things. And we asked him to get back to us with different answers and different things. And it was slow.
Oh yeah.
We had to pull it out of them. And then at some point you kind of walked in and you're like, I think we're just done with this person. I said, yeah, just be done with them. And then we just didn't really respond, and they kind of respond and kind of deselected themselves. But if you drag things out a little bit, particularly in the hiring process, to see how people behave.
Right. And how badly do they
exactly.
want it?
Exactly.
And
right.
How badly do they want to be part of our world and our company? And you can tell the people who do.
Yes.
They're the ones who keep responding. They're the ones who go out and say, I just read this book, and oh, you were recommended these three books too. I just went and read those. And you can tell.
And I don't think you can give this example enough, but it's when you are, if you're in the back of an auditorium and you're trying to run and you're trying to get up on stage, and the stage is the goal for your business, right? And you've got a 300-yard run. Most people, and there's 1,000 people in the audience, most people are what they're doing is they're walking down the middle of the aisle trying to get to the end goal on the stage, and that's their end goal of their business, at least for the foreseeable future. They're grabbing people out of the audience because they can't do it themselves, and they're trying to throw them on their back. They're trying to carry them in a sled. They're trying to put them in front of them. They're trying to kick them when they fall. All these different things, you're trying to put all these people on there, which prevents you from ever getting to the stage because it gets too weighted down that you actually can't move forward with it.
Well, then you end up wanting their career growth and their success more than
exactly
they do.
Exactly.
Which is exhausting.
Yes, it's extremely exhausting, because as soon as you wake up every day and you pull everybody up there and you get to the end of the day, you're like, oh man, that was a lot. And then you wake up the next morning and go, I got to do this again. And that's what burnout causes from, because you don't have the right people around you. Instead of getting back at the auditorium and just running, yelling out your vision, yelling out who you are, yelling out what you're looking for, yelling out where you're going, and you see who stands up and goes, I really like that message, and they start running with you or faster than you. That way you're not pulling anybody, they're pulling you, and then you're supporting them. And so it's an easy analogy to see that. But so when you, in the real world, it is like, are you making this hire because in within 24 hours, because you absolutely need to, and you just throw somebody in the position to get it there. And then you wonder why they're not a Hallie or somebody else in your organization. And, or are you just, are you not really applying? Are you too, the thing is people aren't building the bench, right? There's not a bench for any of these positions.
Or building their own brand, which is back to what we were talking about, attracting talent. Like, are you really clear on who you are, what you want, where you're going? Does it attract people to you so that you can actually build a bench?
Yeah, and it actually goes really well with this quote, right, that it says, hire people who want to work the way you work, who don't get offended by the way you work.
Yeah, I love that for multiple reasons, because we're going through some hires right now, and I'm like, they're hires that are going to be very close to both of us, and not everybody likes the way that we work, but I think we're very clear about how we work, not just through our blog or through our book or through the podcast. But I mean, when we're going through the interviewing process, I mean, we are clear. I to a certain degree, I almost want to scare people off, because they don't know what they're getting into until they get in here. So the more I can prepare them, it's the people who keep coming back and saying, that sounds amazing, I want a part of that, who ultimately end up being the right people.
Yeah, and when you think about it, like if somebody said, hey, I want you to come work on Wall Street with me, what's the first thing that would go through your head about Wall Street?
I hate cities. But the second thing would be, that is 100-hour work weeks.
It's very clear, right? So there's not even like, they don't have to explain that. And that's just their expectation. If you don't want to come in and expected to work 100 hours a week, don't even apply.
Right.
Don't even apply, right? Just don't even do it. And so the same thing, just how do you create a business and an opportunity for people that want to work the way you work, and you don't have to apologize for it. And then the thing is when you have somebody that, when maybe it's your first couple hires and this kind of derails you, right? Somebody's like, well, I can never work for you, doing things. But you're going to hear that. You're going to hear it. That's why I started off by saying the majority of people aren't going to want to work for you. That's what you should. That should be, they shouldn't want to, because if the majority of people want to work, really understand the way you work, right? Then you're probably not very clear on your messaging.
Right. Or what are your standards? What are your expectations? How high do you hold people accountable? If all of that is like middle of the road, then sure, you're going to attract a lot of people who are just like, ah, cool, I can work 30 hours a week and no one's going to hold me accountable.
So what is then, if people listen to this, what is the first couple things they do to kind of start standing out, right? Like what is something that you do, Hallie, in your day, or that just starts me, or that you can give advice, or maybe that you see that I do, or something along those lines, or that's just because you're close, like that is making it so that you go, okay, how do you stand out in whatever league you're playing in, right? Like I'm not playing in Bill Gates's league, right? And there's a whole bunch of leagues in between there, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm not going to be in Bill Gates's league. I'm not going to donate $100 million to the coronavirus that just happened, right? That's an amazing thing that he can do, right? So we're all playing at a different league. But what do you recommend, wherever the league is that somebody's playing at, what do they do to start standing out?
Well, I think for you, it is absolutely that you start by leading yourself first. And you do that. You do that through multiple different ways. And we've talked about that, some of them before on the podcast, by the books that you read, by having a really disciplined morning routine.
I also think, too, that when it comes into it, when you think about not just discipline, it's also... as a leader, you better behave like the person that you know that you need to be to attract the people that you have. And so I think that behavior word is really critical, right? And so it's like, how do you behave as the leader that attracts people? And it's behavior in what Hallie started getting off, and it's like the discipline. It's behavior in how you read books. It's behavior about how you speak to people. It's behavior about your how you behave outside of work that everyone's paying attention to. It's behavior on social media.
Yeah, I was gonna say, what you say yes to, what you say no to.
It's not just one thing. It's actually how you live your life.
How you show up every day.
Yes. And that's what I want people to take away, is it's everything that you do. How do you respond to your kids when they show up? How do you, when all of a sudden shit's hitting the fan, how do you respond? Right. When a tough decision needs to be made and everyone knows what it is, they might not even admit it to you. How do you make that decision? That's how people are watching. That's the behavior that you have to put in, is letting go of the outcome, making peace with that, and making the decision and showing up as that leader, so that then people wake up and go, I didn't want to make that decision. Boy, and I'm glad you did. There's actually an individual that came to me the other day that said, hey, one of the reasons why I'm part of your organization is because I know that there's a lot of things that I just won't make the decision on, and you will.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not saying there's plenty of people that are do it just like I do, right? There's plenty of people that show up that way. And just so how do you start doing that, whatever league that you're playing in, whether you have one employee or zero employees, start showing up that way so you can be the person that then somebody goes, man, I don't know what that guy's doing or woman's doing, but I want to be around that because I want to be part of that because of what they're doing and where they're going and what they're leading.
And who they are just as a person.
Yes. Yeah. But it's like, I don't know how much more granular I can get with it. It's literally every action that you take.
So this is what makes me think of Relentless, the book.
Yes.
It's being a cleaner.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter what role you're in, you know, what job you're in, what company you're in, if you work at home, if you work from home, if you come into an office every day, are you showing up every day as a pro, I don't know how else to say it other than be a cleaner.
Yeah. What I love in that book, Relentless, he talks about like the highest performing athletes, because sports is very easy to kind of watch that way. Like, you know, most athletes show up and they work out during it, but the cleaners are there before and they're there after, and they're there when nobody else knows they're there. Right. Yes. And they're just showing up. Like,
yeah.
you're not doing it necessarily to, so people
see it.
You're just showing up because you have to show up.
Because it's just, you don't know any other way to be.
Like at 4 o'clock in the morning when you wake up and like nobody's watching you and you can skip a workout, you skip a workout. Right. People just see that over time. Right. Like everything you do is going to, when you think about the people that you follow the most, it's who they are, right? Which is then just a reflection of their daily actions, not one action, one time, once a year, like Christmas, right? It's everyday, daily things. So a couple things that you can do. Number one is start by doing something. This is kind of how I explain to you. Start by doing something that people know is hard, right? So again, I don't care what it is. You can do it. I'm just going to give you a couple examples. Maybe it's running a 5K, right? Maybe it's running an Ironman and anyone in between, right? Maybe it's that you're going to start using a 411 because you haven't used the 411, which is just another way to say, I'm going to use a business plan every single day. Maybe it's that you're going to go lose weight. Maybe it's that you're going to
write a book.
Maybe it's you're going to start a blog. Maybe it's that you're going to go do live on Facebook because that's something you've been doing. You pick. I don't care what technique it is that you use. The difference is do you do it? Not just one day, not just 2 days, not for a week, right? I mean, do you do it when everything else is against you that says, don't do this today? Do you still show up to be that person? Because that's how people wake up and go, I know how, they're not going to come up to you. This is what you kind of realize is that people don't walk up to you all the time and go, man, I know how difficult it must be to be your life and like do all these different things and have all this and just kind of lead this and get up every morning and do these different things that you're doing and lead that stuff. And I really appreciate that. And I just want to follow that. They just intuitively know it, right? It doesn't need to be said because your actions are saying it. So there isn't really this kind of acknowledgement of it from your peers or people the majority of the time. So when that doesn't happen, you tend to feel like, well, it's not working. Right. And so people then get lost and like, well, it's not working. I'm not seeing people aren't posting on Facebook about me getting up. And no, they're not going to, but they will follow you. They'll follow you because you know, they know intuitively what you're doing. So you just got to keep showing up to be that person. And if you just start with something, if you figure out whatever technique it is, maybe it's you're going to do meditation, right? Maybe it's you're going to start a journal and you share that your struggles with that. Maybe you start a gratitude morning huddle. Maybe it's just that you just now lead generate for 3 or 4 hours every morning because that's been something that's escaping you. Maybe it's that you go out and hire the next person you need to go hire and you explain to them that like it's a very critical hire for me and I don't really have the money to do it, but I'm going to go do it anyways. Again, it doesn't matter what the technique or the action is. It's that you're doing something that other people know is difficult and that most people won't go out and do. That's how you go right when everyone goes left.
The shirt you're wearing today is actually perfect for this podcast because it says you can't do epic shit with basic people.
Yeah. Well, it's we got our entire organization. I love these shirts, by the way, because it's just so true.
Yeah.
Right. You can't do greatness, right, with basic people. And we're not talking about the human being of the person. We're talking about how they show up every day. So then it comes back to then how do you hire? How do you attract the people that you really want to attract? I'll give you another tactical example on this of how to attract people and how to start learning. Once I really got clear that business building was around people, and you're like, wow, nice insight, Adam. Business equals people. That's great. I get it. Like everyone says they get that, but are your actions actually following the business equals people? Because if you realize that people are what's going to drive your business, when I realized that, I then basically took, this is right when you came on, I basically took 2 years and there's two things that I did. One, I went out and I studied behavior like it just made it my one thing. Behavior, my behavior, other people's behavior. It was neurolinguistics programming. I mean, I got the Chloe Madonna, I think there were CDs back then of what Tony Robbins and Chloe Madonna came together and taught all of their psychologists. I just listened to them over. This is what I did on Saturday and Sunday. So as people understand this, I would get up in the morning and I would listen to these things for 6-7 hours a day, nonstop. I didn't listen to 4 other books. I listened to that book as much as I needed to before I could master it. Right? I just listened over and over and over and over again, right? And I just got it. But that's what I did. I went and mastered everything about behavior, neurolinguistics programming. I went to basically every Tony Robbins event. I would read John. Whatever level I was at, I was just playing at all these different, I was trying to gain as much knowledge around people and understanding people, because leading and understanding people is what business is about. The other thing that I did is then I went around and started paying to go speak everywhere. I mean, like wasn't actually paying it. I was paying for my travel. I was paying for my time. I was paying for my hotels, and I was just speaking for free. And I went all over for 2 or 3 years before we even started getting people just started paying for our travel, right? And I just started speaking. Just speaking everywhere. And I would...
because that's one of the best ways that we found
to attract people. Mm-hmm. And so there's 2 things that I was doing. And so I said, well, if I'm going to be really serious about this people thing, then I'm going to learn about people, including myself, and I'm also going to go attract people by sharing what I'm learning, trying to find the most highly successful people in the country by going around and teaching and speaking and getting your words out there. And this was really, I mean, maybe podcasts were out at the time, but they weren't really doing it at a high level. And really social media really wasn't really, that's 2010, 11, 10 years ago. So that's the message that I went out and did. I did for 2 or 3 years. And now it's really interesting. When that actually happened, I started learning about people. Then my one thing became about consciousness, personal growth, spirituality, which is personal growth is what I was doing all along. But the next trajectory in my life was how do I tie this back to the inward relationship? Right? So it started off by doing everything outwardly. And then I realized business is really about people. So then I went after about people first. That just made it my one thing, right? It's made it my one thing.
Which actually by
years.
Yeah, I was gonna say, and having those people and leading through them actually, I think created a lot of that space for you to then go on to that next level for you.
Exactly right. And then that next level was the next level to be able to bring people that are in my organization or who are thinking about joining an organization or just listening to the things that we're going through to help them in their organizations. Allowed that to be the next chapter of my life. Hey, before you go in, we go. I wanted to make sure everybody was invited to an amazing community that we have on Facebook. This is a conscious coaching Facebook group. It's hosted by myself and Carrie Heibel, our president of coaching. Look, what I love most about the group is the interaction amongst all the members that are in it, that are bringing in questions as how to find talent, to how do I get that voice in my head to stop, to everything in between. And people are bringing in their experiences and their comments. It's a roadmap and a place to go to as you're on this journey through business and spirituality of mixing and merging the two together, realizing I want to grow spiritually, but I don't want to hang out in a cave. And I want to grow business-wise, but I don't also want to make it the means to my end of not having meaning in my life. And so this community comes together to be able to share these ideas, and we tackle a lot of things there. So make sure you go and join. To find the group, just search Join Conscious Coaching on Facebook. And once you do, we look forward to connecting with you there.